you guys are tired, man. I'm like, so what am I going to say to this guy? I'm like, bonsai. I'm like, bonsai. And he kind of smiles a little bit and takes off. The first off-road race I ever went to was the 1992 Baja 1000. And one of my friends went to the Rod Hall Driving School up in Reno, and he hit it off with them real good. And they asked him if they'd help him at the Baja 1000. So he's like, yeah, heck yeah. And he asked me, and I'm like, oh yeah, let's do this. You know, I'd never been to a race, kind of looked at some magazine stuff, and I was like, well, it looks badass. We went down the night before contingency, stayed with the Halls, Ensenada, we were at Papagayos, just amazing, right on the water there. We had to head to our spot that day, so we left about 3 o'clock, and the Halls were running 3 trucks. It was a class one, because there was no trophy truck back then. It was just, there were class one, they had trucks, it was unlimited. And so they had a class one truck, class four truck, class eight truck. So our job, we were new guys, so we didn't really have an important job. So they wanted us to go down to mile 750, which was south of La Purisima. And it was just outside of Kamandu. It was a pretty iconic shale hill climb with some switchbacks in it. And they said they want us up there. If the race trucks come through and somebody's in the way, just make sure they're out of the way, because they're pretty sure they can make it up the hill. But they just didn't want anybody in their way. So no problem, we could do that. So headed down with a bunch of their guys. They got us a room in Guerrero Negro. Coming down the hill into El Rosario, the right rear brake just exploded in my buddy's Bronco, my buddy Chad. So we made it down to the Pemex down there, pulled the drum off. Everything was just scrambled. So gutted everything out of there, had some vice grips, crimped the brake line shut, taped it to the axle. All right, let's go. Got down to Guerrero, I don't know, 3 in the morning or something like that. We didn't care. We were young, man. It was all good. Slept like 4 or 5 hours because we had a good journey ahead of us. Headed out about 8 in the morning. Got to the hill climb. We were kind of nervous. Got right up it. It was no problem. So the only ones there was a big Honda pit and us, basically, in the middle of nowhere. It was awesome. And we got there, I don't know, 3 in the afternoon or so. Kind of went over, talked to the Honda guys a bunch. And my family's in the radio business, so we put a big, huge antenna up, had the radio, had all the frequencies, had weatherman going, scanners. And so we caught over the radio that all three of our trucks were down. None of them were through Bay of LA yet. Two of them had blown motors. One of them, it was a tranny, but it was way down. They had to go around the Valley T and come back down through San Felipe. And it was gonna be like next day before we maybe saw them. So anyway, so we're like, okay, well, time for a beer, man. So we started drinking, having a good time, and talking to the Honda guys a bunch. And probably about dark, I think it was, we could hear the first bike coming. On the pipe, man, just rah, rah, rah. Danny Hamill comes flying through, throwing rocks everywhere. We were just like, hell yeah, this is awesome. We were bike guys, you know, and we were so pumped. And then first bike came through. So in those days, it was a big deal for Japanese riders to come over and ride in the Baja 1000. There was always like probably 50 of them come over. It was a big pack. And it was like, I guess it was really prestigious and stuff like that. If you go back to Japan, you ran the 1000, you were the man. And I don't think any of them pre-ran. I think they're all kind of mediocre riders. Anyway, we saw them all contingency. And so they started coming through about midnight, 1 in the morning. So one, I don't know if it was the first one or not, but one comes through, just piles it right in front of us. Boom. Like, all right, we got there, we get his bike up, we put him on his bike, pushing him up, piles it again. Boom, we put him on his bike, we finally get him to the top of the hill. I'm like, man, and you could tell he didn't speak any English, so we were kind of trying to communicate with him. And so I'm like, man, these guys are tired, man. I'm like, so what am I gonna say to this guy? I'm like, bonsai. I'm like, bonsai. And he kind of smiles a little bit and takes off. Anyway, so go back down the hill. Here comes another one. Boom, just piles right in front of us. After the second crash, I'm like, all right, hey, you know what? You walk uphill, me, I'll ride the bike. He's like, oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. So I'm like, all right, man. And back, I have shorts on, no helmet. And back then I rode every day. So I got it up the hill and I knew I had a little bit of time. So around the Honda pit, down this valley, rah, there's a tree down the end, around the tree, rah, came back, boom. And I had a good minute to spare. He came up, got on the bike, and bonsai, took off. And so I walked back down. Here comes another one. Same thing, man. After about a couple crashes, I said, I'm gonna ride your bike up. He's like, okay. So I figured I had a little more time, so I went around the tree. I found a couple little jumps into the wash, around a couple rocks, back. Yeah, and I still had a little bit of time. So about the fourth guy, I made my track a little longer, and I got it dialed in a little more. And, you know, some of these bikes were bent up, some of them were sweet. And so, I mean, that night I probably, and then we always do the bonsai when we put them on it. I probably rode like 12 to 15 bikes up the hill that night. And the Honda guys were just cracking up, man. They were laughing so hard.
Hey guys, I hope you enjoyed that story. Now, if you've been racing for a while and would like to share your story, please reach out to us in the links provided and help us achieve our goal of spreading racing stories to those outside the race car.